I often come across interesting things that aren't substantial enough to warrant an entire video of their own, so I wait until I've collected a few of them and then I create a compilation video like this one. It's only the second one I've ever made, but they're really fun. All right, interesting thing number one is about tape measures. Have you ever noticed that tape measure manufacturers seem incapable of creating nice, sturdy tabs that don't move around? Like, look at the horrible wobble on this one. Surely we've perfected the riveting process to the point where we don't have to suffer these mechanical failures. And of course, it turns out that these tabs wobble for a reason. And it's all to do with the way we use tape measures to measure things. There are basically two different ways you can use a tape measure. You can measure the outside dimension of something or the inside dimension of something. Let's assume for a moment that the tab is fixed, that it isn't wobbly, and you're measuring the outside dimension of something. If you measure the outside dimension, then what you do is you hook the tab over the thing you want to measure, and then you pull the tape measure backwards until you reach your mark. In this case, you're interested in the distance from the inside face of the tab. And you can imagine that the tape measure would be calibrated for that purpose when it leaves the factory. But then when you want to measure the inside dimension of something, you'll push the tab up against the inside surface of the thing that you want to measure. And in that scenario, the measurement you're after is the measurement that starts from the outside face of the tab. But this thing's been calibrated for the inside face of the tab. So the solution is to have a tab with a little bit of travel. And it's just enough travel to compensate for the thickness of the tab itself. Interesting thing number two, why do hammerhead sharks have hammer-shaped heads? Well, it's at least partially to do with depth perception. You might know that having two eyes improves your ability to perceive how far away things are due to something called binocular vision that gives you a skill called stereopsis. Basically, the image coming from your two eyes are slightly different because they're in slightly different positions, and your brain is able to interpret those subtle differences in the two images as information about depth, information about how far away things are. And the further apart your eyes are, the more different those two images will be, and so the more accurately you will be able to perceive depth. And you'll be able to perceive differences in depth to greater distances. So for whatever reason, the hammerhead shark occupies this evolutionary niche of being good at perceiving depth in the ocean. To have binocular vision, you need to have overlap between the two images coming from your eyes. And if you look at a hammerhead shark, you might think, well, those eyes seem to be really pointing out sideways, like maybe there isn't any overlap between the images coming from those eyes. And actually, interesting sub-fact, let's call it interesting thing 2.1, prey animals tend to have eyes on the sides of their heads, so they've got good wraparound vision for detecting predators coming from all different directions, whereas predator animals tend to have eyes on the fronts of their heads, so they've got good overlap and they can perceive how far away their prey is. Anyway, some scientists did some studies and it does seem as though there is overlap between the images coming from the two hammerhead shark eyes. And they hypothesized that hammerhead sharks improve the overlap of the images by moving their heads side to side as they swim. I won't do an impression. I will do an impression. This guy's doing a slightly better impression than me. Slightly, mind you. Interesting thing number three. If my wife needed a kidney, I probably wouldn't be able to give her one of mine. In fact, I would be the number one worst person in the whole entire world to try and give her a kidney. And that's because we've had kids together. So, genetically speaking, our kids are 50% Leanne and 50% me. That means that some of the proteins that my kids produce are the same as the proteins that I produce because they're produced by my genes and they have those genes. Whereas Leanne doesn't produce those proteins because she has different genes. So when my wife gave birth to our kids, her body was exposed to these proteins that her body doesn't produce, and her immune system recognized those proteins as foreign. So now her immune system is primed to deal with those proteins in the future. So if we tried to take one of my kidneys and transplant it into Leanne, her immune system would almost certainly reject it as foreign. And It's a tragic irony, really, because of all the people in the world, I'm the one that would most want to be able to give her a kidney. She doesn't need a kidney, by the way. This is hypothetical, except it's not hypothetical for a lot of people. So what do you do in this situation? I mean, I could sell my kidney and then use that money to buy another kidney that is compatible with Leanne, except that in most societies, we've decided that we shouldn't be exchanging money for organs, at least not at market value. So instead, we have the kidney exchange program where I say, look, I want my wife to have a kidney. She can't have mine, so I'm going to give my kidney to anyone who needs it, so long as my wife gets a kidney in the bargain. And so they'll pair us up with another pair of people who've had kids together, where the father wants to give a kidney to the mother, but he can't. So they on this database of, you know, compatibilities and stuff like that, you find one where that person's kidney is compatible with my wife, and my kidney is compatible with that person's baby mother, essentially. So you do a kidney swap. Kidney swap. Interesting thing number four, the North Pole is a South Pole. So you know the Earth is a giant magnet. Well, it turns out that the South Pole of that magnet is at the top where the North Pole is. And that's not because like the poles flip every few thousand years, like that hasn't happened in human history. It's to do with the way we talk about magnets. So like the magnet in a compass, for example. So if you've got a bar magnet, one end is attracted in the direction that we call north, and the other end of the bar magnet is attracted in the direction that we call south. So we've got the north attracting end of the magnet and the south attracting end of the magnet, except we don't call it that. We just call it the north end and the south end, or the north pole and the south pole of the magnet. And because with magnetism, opposite poles attract, the north pole of your magnet or the needle in your compass must be pointing towards the south pole of the Earth's magnet. In other words, the magnetic field of the Earth has its south pole at the top where the north pole is. Interesting thing number five, this ant. Look at its head. It's a turtle ant. This one's a soldier, and it's grown a door on its head. Its head is a door. So these are tree-dwelling ants. They live inside tree trunks, and they cut out a circular entrance to their burrow, and then they guard that entrance with their heads. It's an example of phragmosis, when you use your body to block the entrance to your burrow as a form of defense. Here's another example. It's the Chinese hourglass spider, and it uses its bum. A totally unrelated interesting thing is that Oreos are vegan.
Which means they're healthy.
I reckon I'll keep making videos of this format just every now and again. So I've set up a website to track the interesting things, partly because I want it to be searchable outside of the YouTube ecosystem. I wanted each interesting thing to have its own image. Like on YouTube, you only get one image per video. It's the thumbnail. So I wanted that too. Also, I'd just like to see this growing list of interesting things. It's called ninteristingthings.com, and I've set it up with the sponsor of this video, which is Hostinger. Things I like so far, it's got two-factor authentication, which is really important to me. I like to do things in the nerdy way. So, you know, I tend to build websites with a static site generator where appropriate. And then if I can deploy it with Git, even better. And you can do that with Hostinger. Git push. There it is. I appreciate that's not for everyone. So I was looking at kind of, you know, what can you do at the other end? And so Hostinger, they love WordPress. I was reading some of the documentation about how they've optimized their servers for WordPress. And it's one of those, it's like, you know, one click install type thing. And then once you've got WordPress running, content management's super easy. So you can go either way with Hostinger. You can go the really nerdy route with Git push, or you can go the much easier route with WordPress, and then it's got everything else in between, just uploading files, whatever you want to do. I recommend you check it out. You know, setting up websites can be daunting if you've not done it before, but it doesn't have to be. If you go to hostinger.com/Steve Mould, you can get up to 91% off yearly web hosting plans when you use the promo code Steve Mould at checkout. So yeah, have a look today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and I'll see you next time.